السلام عليكم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهدي الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله، فصلى الله عليه صلاة وسلاما يليقان بمقام سيد الأنبياء وإمام المرسلين. Dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran always reminds us to be mindful of Him in multiple occasions. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته. Believers, be mindful of Allah as He deserves to be mindful of. And try your best to end your life in a state of submission, in a state of Islam. Allah says, وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. Brothers and sisters, one of my teachers, one of my mentors, gave the example of our hearts, our nafs, like a battery. Many of us have smartphones or devices that they need to be charged continuously. And the more you use your smartphone, the more you watch on it, stream on it, talk on it, the more it depletes, the battery goes down faster. And it will always tell you low battery. And if the phone is in low battery mode, you cannot function well. You always have to keep it plugged. Subhanallah. And if you think about bigger batteries, some of us started driving electric cars, for example. I personally have driven an electric car from here to Ohio, and I had to be mindful of what they call range and anxiety. You have to be always careful that you have enough mileage to take you to the next charging station. So the bigger the battery is, the more demand it will require, because it's driving a car with, I don't know, 4,000 pounds or what have you. So the bigger the battery is, the more you have to be mindful about charging it more often. SubhanAllah, so my teacher says that we have to think about our nafs, which is both the combination of a soul and a body. And the soul comes before the body. You are not a body that has a soul. You are a soul that has a body. That's how we should think of ourselves. Our nafs, soul plus body, needs to be charged on a regular basis. We just finished Ramadan. Alhamdulillah, many of us felt full in Ramadan. Our battery, our iman was full. But also it gets depleted due to many reasons. If you miss a salat, the battery gets discharged. If you sin or commit a mistake, the battery will be go down. But other than the sins, there are many reasons for people's batteries to be depleted quickly, such as being fearful of the people. The more fear we have, al-khawf min al-nas, the more we feel fearful of other people, subhanallah, the battery of iman will deplete quickly, subhanallah. Let me give an example. When we feel helpless, when we feel betrayed by others, when we feel that other people have let us down, when a sister who was telling me a few days ago that her job was discriminating against her because she's a woman and because she's a Muslimah, and she was going in circles, subhanAllah, and she was being oppressed because of that, and alhamdulillah, she had the courage to speak out to HR, and alhamdulillah, HR stood by her, and she was able to get her rights. But being in that fearful situation from the people will immediately deplete the battery of iman that you have in your heart. When a brother, a young man who may fail college multiple times, and every time he looks at himself in the mirror, and his parents talk to him, look at your neighbor, look at your friends, look at your high school classmates, where are they right now? When they start comparing themselves to others, this will definitely affect and shake one's iman, subhanAllah. It could be a black brother who's driving on the highway, as many shared their experience with me, and when they get pulled over by a police, by a cop, they know, they define themselves, they rehearse in their mind what they have to say. Because if they move, any movement that's wrong, they may get humiliated, arrested, or even killed. That feeling of being fearful of the people, subhanAllah, it really affects and depletes our battery of iman. It could be our brothers and sisters in Palestine who see death every single day, who see discrimination every single day, who cannot even pray in their own masjid, al-masjid al-Aqsa, which is in their backyard, because they're Palestinians. And they see, even when it comes to a Christian, American citizen, journalist, like Shireen Abu Aqli, who was murdered in cold blood by the IDF, Israeli Defensive Forces, which should be called Israeli Offensive Forces, occupying forces. Imagine how much fear they will have in their lives on a regular basis. That specific journalist and reporter entered the homes of every Muslim and every passionate person about Palestine. And she was murdered, and the whole world has seen. And we yet expect to see the flags and the slogans of standing with Palestine as they did with Ukraine. Maybe because Palestinians don't have blonde hair. Maybe because Palestinians are not European enough or not civilized enough. So Shireen Abu Aqli, who have exposed the hypocrisy of the world that we live in. So back to our topic, all of these feelings of fear affect our heart, affect our battery, and we start paying so much attention to what other people have to do. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribed for us a dhikr, a dua, a supplication that should strengthen the iman and the resolve in our hearts. And I want everybody who felt sometimes weak, and all of us have this moment, to memorize this dua. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about the believers in the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who felt that the whole people, all of Arabia, are conspiring against them. They are coming to kill them. They're plotting against them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytanir rajim. الذين قال لهم الناس إن الناس قد جمعوا لكم فاخشوهم. Allah is praising the Sahaba, the companions of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who just got out of the battle of Uhud, when 70 of the best companions were murdered, were butchered. Some of them, Hamza bin Abdul Muttalib, the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Sayyid al-Shuhada, the master of martyrs. And here's a quick note here. When we say martyr in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have to be careful with our wording. Brothers and sisters, I know this statement that I will say right now will make some of us angry, because many of us are politically influenced and charged and emotional. And it's okay to be emotional. But it is an amana, a trust. If I stand on this minbar, I have to tell you what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. I cannot always tell you what pleases your ear. When we say a shaheed in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when I say rahmatullah alayhi, when I make dua for Allah to mercy somebody, that person has to be a Muslim, has to be somebody who submits to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who believes in Allah and the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So yes, somebody might be a hero, somebody might be a figure, somebody that we praise a lot, like the deceased journalist. But I cannot go beyond and above and beyond what Islam teaches me. I have seen some pictures for people praying Salat al-Janaza on a Christian journalist who passed away in Palestine. And this does not add up. We have to understand that when it comes to the scale of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, iman and faith comes first. And I know some brothers are not happy with this statement, but it's an amana for me to say. I'm not trying to be cruel or trying to be intolerant when I say this. I just say what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught me and what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us. In fact, we have in the seerah, I know this is a tangent, but it's a very important tangent, so that we don't end up praying Salat al-Janaza, the funeral prayer, on somebody who's not a Muslim. When Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his uncle Abu Talib, who served Islam more than anyone else, who stood by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than anyone else. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who recognized that Abu Talib served Islam more than any other person can imagine. Me and you are Muslims today, maybe because of Abu Talib and his sacrifice to the Muslim community. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was begging Abu Talib on his deathbed, يا عماه قل كلمة لا إله إلا الله أحاج لك بها عند الله. My dear uncle, say لا إله إلا الله at least once, so that all of your good deeds I can argue for you, for your behalf, next to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Abu Talib chose to stay on the kufr. Abu Talib chose to stay on the disbelief. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, out of his human weakness, I want to understand, Prophet is a human being like me and you. He has the same emotions that we have. He was asking, why? I wish I can make dua for my uncle. So he told Abu Talib after he passed away, يا عمّاه لا أستغفرن لك ما لم أنها. I will make istighfar for you. I will ask Allah to forgive you unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbids me to do so. And Allah revealed an ayah in the Quran, يا جماعة. I know it's a tangent. Again, it's a very important tangent. Because I don't want the murder of a Palestinian journalist in Palestine, in Jenin, to become and end up and trickle down to the murder of a lot of people's aqidah. Normally, I wouldn't mention this. Wallahi, I don't think we should discuss whether we should say رحمه الله أو لا رحمه الله. That's not the point. We should focus on the crimes of the Israeli occupation. That's the highest priority. But me, as somebody who's standing on the minbar of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I have to say this, the word of truth, the Quran and the Sunnah. That's my amana. So the Prophet pledged that he will make istighfar to his uncle who died on a state of paganism. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, مَا كَانَ لِلنَّبِيِّ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَنْ يَسْتَغْفِرُوا لِلْمُشْرِكِينَ وَلَوْ كَانُوا أُولِي قُرْبَى. It doesn't befit for the Prophet and the believers to make istighfar, to ask for forgiveness for the pagans, even if they are relatives. And by the way, the Prophet was not making istighfar to Abu Talib because he was a relative, because it's his uncle, because we have no favoritism in Islam. Because Abu Talib stood by the Muslims, truly. But he died as a kafir. من بعد ما تبين لهم أنهم أصحاب الجحيم. Even Prophet Ibrahim, Prophet Ibrahim, Khalilullah, the friend of Allah, he told his father, قال سلام عليك سأستغفر لك ربي. I will make istighfar for you. His father, who was a kafir. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade him from doing that. So as believers, and wallahi, it's hard for me to say this because I personally was raised on watching the news of Palestine from the brave journalist, Shireen. I was raised from on her being the spoke of the oppressed, being the voice of the oppressed. So it's hard for us to say this because we are human beings, like our messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a human being. لكن كلام الله أحق. The aqeedah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to be said, subhanallah. Back to the story, the dua, the zikr of everybody who is oppressed, everybody who feels suffocated, everybody who feels unheard, everybody who feels that people are conspiring against me. The dua that Allah taught us in the Quran, وَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَا اللَّهُ وَنَعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ الَّذِينَ قَالَ لَهُمُ النَّاسُ إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ فَخْشَوْهُمْ. The Sahaba, after the battle of Uhud, they were defeated. 70 of the best companions were murdered. Hamza was murdered. Sayyid al-Shuhada, he is the master of the martyrs. They were murdered. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, some people thought he was killed. Some Sahaba left the battlefield, dropped their weapons, and they said, we are not fighting if the Prophet died. Some Sahaba started to question their faith. Are we on the right path? If we are on the right path, why did we get defeated? You see, subhanAllah, politics and being defeated in the war and the battlefield does affect people's faith. This is a test that we are all living in when we see Muslims being killed on a regular basis. It's hard on the heart. Some Sahaba abandoned the battlefield and they went away. But some did not. Some were steadfast. If the Prophet ﷺ died, let us go and fight. And let us die the same way he died. And when they were told that the pagans are attacking you again, they will come to the Medina again, they were supposed to be fearful. They just murdered us in the first battle. 70 were killed. What about now? More people will kill us. فَخْشَوْهُمْ, so fear them. فَزَادَهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَا اللَّهُ وَنَعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. This increased them in faith. This increased them in the conviction. Some people, when they are tested, their faith is shaken. But some, when they are tested, you see them coming closer to Allah, raising their hands, doing more dhikr, doing more dua, coming to ask and consult and counsel with people of knowledge. And this is a sign of true faith. Some brother was asking me the other day, I was tested, I was afflicted with a calamity. How do I know? Is it a punishment from Allah? Or is it a test to elevate my ranks? And normally the answer is very simple. Look at your actions after the test. If that calamity or test is bringing you closer to Allah, it's to elevate your ranks. If that test or calamity is distancing you away from Allah, it could be a punishment. Watch out. Subhanallah. Your actions decide whether whatever we are going through or you are going through in your personal life or communal life is a test from Allah to elevate your ranks, or wa'iyadu billah, it is a punishment. فَزَادَهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنَعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنَعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ means Allah is enough for me, and He is the best one to take care of my affairs. حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنَعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ is a perspective change. It's a change in perspective. Instead of going to Allah and telling Allah, I have a big problem, you go to your problem and say to your problem, I have a big Lord, big Master, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? لا تقول يا الله عندي هم كبير ولكن قل للهم عندي رب كبير. You go to that problem and you say, Allahu Akbar, Allah is bigger than you. حسبي الله ونعم الوكيل gives you clarity, reminds us that Allah is in control, not those enemies, not those conspiring against you or discriminating against you or abusing you. حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنَعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنَعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ gives us clarity. Sometimes we were driving in a foggy weather. And you know, you cannot even see the car in front of you. And you see so many trucks going left and right, and you are scared and you're fearful. You have your kids with you. You have your wife or your spouse with you. It's a scary situation. حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنَعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ gives you clarity. Reminds you that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in control. You may not see the car next to you, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching over you. So make sure you do your part and say hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel. Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel keeps your heart filled with positive energy and positive medicine. As Abu Zayd al-Balkhi rahimahullah, who was one of the early Muslim psychotherapists, used to say that sometimes it's very important to keep the medicine ready, so that when your soul, when your heart goes down, you have the medicine ready. How can you get the medicine? By making sure that you say Hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel always, continuously, not only at the times of calamity, but all year round, at times of ease and times of hardship. Brothers and sisters, it's so hard to see Muslims being killed on a regular basis. It's so hard to see oppression. It's so hard to see that even those allies from the non-Muslim community that we thought they are with us, we thought that they feel our pain, that they feel the racism that we're getting through, that they are not even speaking a word when an American citizen, Christian, is being murdered. It's so hard to see this. It's so hard to see injustice in this world. But that's why we have to say, حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنَعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. Allah is enough with us, number one. Number two, instead of focusing about what that person will be, their destination in Jannah or in Hellfire, that's not our business, it's Allah's business. Don't get me wrong, it's Allah who decides at the end of the day, not me and you. I cannot pray on her, I cannot say rahimahullah, but again, the destination is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What we should focus on is to go to all of our allies, everybody, every free person, everyone who believes in social justice, and ask them, where is your solidarity? Where is your brotherhood? Where is the belief in humanity? She was wearing a press vest, ya jama'ah, yani, subhanallah. And people did not say anything about it. We should focus our efforts as Muslims, and I know many of us here have influential positions, raising awareness. I know there's a rally coming up in Dearborn, the city of Dearborn. Very importantly, with this mihna, this test, this calamity should not shake our faith. Should not shake our conviction that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَاللَّهُ مُتِمُّ نُورِهِ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْكَافِرُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will complete His light, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will complete His affairs. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable us to serve the oppressed everywhere in the world. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to end the oppression of our brothers and sisters all over the world. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم. فاستغفروه فيا فوز المستغفرين. الحمد لله وكفى، والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى، لا سيما نبينا المصطفى، ومن بسنته وآثاره اقتدى واقتفى واكتفى. Brothers and sisters, subhanAllah, when we talk about Palestine and when we talk about the oppression in Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, we're talking about a land that is dear and near to our hearts and the hearts of every Muslim, not only somebody who goes and is a descendant of the Palestinian, you know, nation or tribe or nationality. Every Muslim who loves Mecca and Medina loves Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, because Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa is the third holy site in Islam. It is the first Qibla that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the early Muslims prayed towards for 16 months before their Qibla was directed towards Mecca. It is the sacred place, it's Ardul Anbiya, it is the land where all the prophets belonged to, where Prophet Ibrahim was there, Musa alayhi salam went there or tried to go there, Yusuf alayhi salam descends from there. It is the holy land where the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam led all the prophets in the night journey in Rahlat al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. It is a surah, it is a land, it's a holy land that is documented in Surah al-Isra, chapter number 50, chapter number 17 in the Holy Quran. سبحان الذي أسرى بعبده ليلا من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله. Praiseworthy is the one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who let his servant travel in the night journey from Mecca, from the holy masjid, to Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to revive the love of Palestine and Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa in the hearts of all of us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable us to support our brothers and sisters all over the world. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to end the oppression and help us say the word of truth with our hands, with our tongues, and with our hearts. Allahumma aghfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina wa thabbit aqdamana. Allahumma inna na'udhu bika an nadhilla aw nudhal aw nazilla aw nuzal aw nadhlima aw nudhlam aw najhala aw yajhal alayna. اللهم انصر دينك وكتابك وسنة نبيك صلى الله عليه وسلم وعبادك الصالحين، وارفع الغل والحسد والضغينة من قلوبنا. اللهم وحد صفوفنا، اللهم وحد صفوفنا، اللهم وحد صفوفنا. اللهم اهدنا واهد بنا، واجعلنا سببا لمن اهتدى، واهد الناس على أيدينا. اللهم أقر أعيننا بعودة الأقصى إلى ديار المسلمين، اللهم أقر أعيننا بعودة الأقصى إلى ديار المسلمين. اللهم انصر عبادك المستضعفين في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها، واجعل لنا في نصرتهم أوفر الحظ والنصيب. اللهم أعنا على أن نغير ما بأنفسنا حتى تغير ما بنا، وصل اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، وأقم الصلاة.